Hello guys, welcome to another video. Today we are going to talk about transfer between categories. I mean to say, like, when we invest in the debt securities, so at the time of investment we can classify those investment either as trading securities or available for sale securities or held to maturity securities. Trading securities are those investment for which as an investor you have an intention to sell in the near future. Those are called trading securities, and held to maturity securities will include only the bonds. If as an investor you have a positive intention and you have a ability to hold the bonds until the maturity date, that is called held to maturity securities. But as an investor, if you are not clear or if you didn't classify as trading or held to maturity securities, so those investment could be classified as available for sale securities. So here we are going to talk about the transfer between categories. I mean to say, like, when you will classify available for sale securities as trading, or maybe you are going to classify trading as available for sale securities, or maybe you have a held to maturity securities which you are going to classify as trading, or maybe the trading securities you are going to classify as held to maturity securities, or maybe available for sale securities you are going to classify as held to maturity, or maybe held to maturity security you are going to classify as available for sale securities. So what will happen actually, before going into that topic, just let's have a quick overview what we learned when we studied these trading securities, available for sale securities, or held to maturity securities. It's just a small recap what we did. So when we talk about that trading securities, so trading securities could be classified as current assets or non-current assets. It depends upon the nature and the purpose of investment. And these trading securities are reported at fair value at the date of balance sheet. And whatever you have unrealized gains or losses, these unrealized gains or losses are taken to the net income, I mean to say to the income statement. And when it comes to the cash flow statement, so these trading securities could be classified as operating cash flows also or as investing. But if you have classified your trading securities as current assets, so then we will treat as operating cash flows. If you have classified your trading securities as non-current asset, then it should be classified as investing activities. Okay, so then we have available for sale securities. So again, available for sale securities we can record as a current asset or non-current assets. It depends on the nature and the purpose of investment. And these available for securities also reported at fair value, but changes in the fair value due to the changes, whatever you will have unrealized gain or losses, that will be taken to the other comprehensive income. And in the cash flow statement, we treat as investing activities. So then you have a held to maturity securities. Held to maturity securities could be your current asset or your non-current asset. Actually, it depends upon the maturity period. If maturity period is less than 1 year, so you can classify as current. If maturity, remaining maturity period is more than 1 year, you can classify as non-current asset. And these securities we reported at amortized cost, which we have already covered in previous videos. And here you don't calculate any unrealized gains or losses. The reason is that these securities are not marked to market. And when it comes to the cash flow statement, we treat as investing activities. So here we are going to talk about transfer between categories. So here we have a rule, either when you are going to classify your trading securities or available for sale securities or held to maturity securities to any maybe trading, available for sale or held to maturity, I mean to say from any category to any other category, if you are going to reclassify your investments, so there is a simple rule. The reclassification should be done at fair value at the date of transfer from one category to the other category. This is what is the rule. So fair value you should remember, and whatever you will have unrealized holding gain or losses due to changes in the fair value at the date of reclassification, this is how you will deal with it. Let's have a look through the help of data. So here we have here, if you are transferring from trading categories, I mean, say from trading securities to any other categories, maybe you are going to reclassify as held to maturity securities, or you are going to classify as available for sale securities from the trading. Okay. So if this is the case, whatever under it, because you should remember here, trading securities are measured at fair value at the reporting date, and held to maturity securities measured at amortized cost, and available for sale securities also measured at fair value. So whatever you will have unrealized holding gain or losses at the date of transfer, so you will record in the earnings. If it has already been recognized in the earnings, I mean, in the income statement, it should not be reversed. This is the rule you should remember. So then we have a second category. So maybe you are going to shift from held to maturity or from available for sale securities, and we are going to classify as now as a trading category in this scenario, because you should remember again, held to maturity securities measured at amortized cost, and available for sale securities are measured at fair value. So because at the date of reclassification, again, you need to check the fair value if you will have any unrealized holding gain or losses at the date of transfer, it shall be recognized in earning immediately. Okay. So because trading categories will measured at fair value. Okay. So then third, we have a third scenario, because this scenario we will practice through the questions to understand in a better way. So you might have a, if you have a held to maturity securities and you are going to transferred to as available for sale securities, it means from held to maturity, we are going to transfer as available for sale securities. And you should remember again, held to maturity securities are measured at amortized cost, and available for sale securities are measured at fair value, and unrealized gains or losses we are recording in OCI. Okay, this is the normal treatment. So if you're going to classify held to maturity securities as available for sale securities, whatever the unrealized holding gain or losses you will have, you will report in other comprehensive income. And please remember, because available for sale securities, the changes in the fair values we are recording in OCI. So that is why you will take it to the other comprehensive income. Okay. Then you have a fourth scenario. If you have available for sale securities and you are going to classify as now held to maturity securities, again, available for sale securities was measured at fair value, and unrealized gains or losses we have recorded in OCI, but held to maturity securities is going to be recorded at amortized cost. So you are going to shift available from for sale to held to maturity. In this scenario, whatever you have unrealized holding gain or losses at the date of transfer is already reported in other comprehensive income, because available for sale security was measured at fair value through OCI. Okay. So you have already recorded there. Now what you need to do? So simply you need to amortize those unrealized holding gain or losses. You need to amortize over the remaining life of the security. Maybe you might have their certain gain as unrealized gain in OCI. What you need to do here, for example, you have a gain of 1,000. Maybe your remaining life is 5 years. So what you need to do, maybe every year, so what you will do, 200, you will amortize. If you have a loss, of course, the gain you should amortize. If you have a loss also, you should also amortize from, you have to remove from the equity section actually, and you have to take it to the income statement. Okay, this is what we need to do here. So it will, you can amortize as the same way as we can, we are amortizing any amount of premium or discount. So maybe it is very complicated. So let me help you through the summary and then we will practice few questions. So here you should remember this is from, like from where you are going to transfer. This is column for two, I mean say where you are going to transfer, and this is earning recognition, what to do with the unrealized gains or losses. If you're going to transfer from trading securities to any other category, I mean say maybe you are going to transfer to available for sale or to held to maturity securities. So whatever unrealized holding gain or losses you have already recognized in income statement, it will not be reversed. Then you have any other category. Any other category mean to say maybe you have available for sale or held to maturity. From those categories, we are going to classify as trading securities now. So what we need to do here, what we will do if you have any recognized, if you didn't recognize any gain or losses, now you have to recognize the gain or losses, and this gain or losses, you will take it to the income statement, because don't forget, we are going to shift to the trading. Okay. Then if you have a held to maturity securities, from held to maturity, you are going to classify as available for sale securities. Now what you will do, if you have any unrealized gain or losses, now those will be recorded in OCI. Then you have available for sale securities. From available for sale, you are going to shift to the held to maturity securities. In this scenario, whatever amounts we have in OCI, so it will not be reversed, but we need to amortize in the same way as premium or discount. This is what is the summary. Now let's have a look how the question they might ask in the exam. So here we have a question number one. So let's have a look first, what is the requirement? The question is, what is the net effect of the above items on Smoke's net income? I mean, say on the income statement for the year ended 31st December, year three. So you have to calculate the effects for year three only. So here we have our data now. The following information to Smoke Inc. investment in debt securities. And here we have on December 31st, year three, Smoke reclassified a security acquired during the year for 70,000. Like this is what you have a cost, okay, of 70,000. It had $50,000 fair value when it was reclassified from trading to available for sale securities. So it happens actually in a third year. So if you will look at here, in the year three, your cost was how much? 70,000. But you are gonna to transfer to the this was classified previously as trading, but now you are gonna to transfer to the available for sale securities. From trading, we are going to available for sale securities, and the fair value at the date of transfer is, the fair value is $50,000. So you can check it there. So there is a loss of unrealized, I will use the word unrealized, loss of how much? We have a loss of $20,000. Okay. So this is the loss which should be reported in the income statement of year three. Okay. So we got one value. We have here loss, unrealized loss of $20,000. So then we have another transaction in and available for sale securities costing 75,000, written down to 30,000. In year two, question is about year three. So actually in year two, what happened? There was a cost of 75,000, and now you have reduced the value to the 30,000 because there is a other than temporary impairment. I mean, say there was an impairment of how much if you will take what happened in year two actually. So your cost was 75,000, but you have reduced the investment to 30,000. Okay, because there is a 45,000 was, there is a impairment actually. Okay, this is the permanent decline in the value of asset. Now what happened in year three? So it means your investment was showing at $30,000 in year two in the balance sheet. This is a value which is reflected in the balance sheet in year two. But don't forget, question is about year three. Now, next part of the information they're telling you, it had a 60,000 fair value on December 30, year three. It means in year three, what happened actually? In year three, you are, if you have an investment which was showing in year two in the balance sheet at 30,000. Now it has a fair value in year three balance sheet date. It has fair value of $60,000. So now you can see there is a gain of 30,000. So this gain is called unrealized gain. And as I told you, when you transfer from, it's not a transfer. So when you have unrealized gain, especially on available for sale securities, this gain, you will take it to the OCI. But if you will look at the question is about how much value the gain or loss, you will take it to the income statement. So this 30,000 will go to the OCI, and this here 30,000, you have impairment loss. This is related to year two. It's not relevant here. It means in year three, we have only one information and we have a loss of $20,000, which you will take it to the income statement in year three. So our answer is in year three, we have a loss of 20,000, which you will take it to the income statement. This is what is our answer here. Okay. Then you have here another question. Question number two, we have a Sun Corporation had investment in trading debt securities costing 650,000 on June 30, year two. This is actually your date of transfer. Sun decided to hold this investment indefinitely. When it is indefinitely, what we will do, we will reclassify as available for sale debt securities on that day. Okay, so actually what we are going to do here, from trading securities, because here they told you it was a trading securities, and we are going to transfer to available for sale securities. Here he told you because we shifted to the available for sale securities. Okay, and what is the date is 30th June is the date of transfer. Now they're telling you the investment fair value was 575,000 at 31st December year one. This is the value. And we have a 530,000 at 30th June year two. This is a fair value at June 30 year two, because at the date of transfer. Okay. And we have 490,000 at December 31st year two. This is the, at the end of second year, we have fair value 490,000. The question is, the decrease in fair value of the security is not due to credit losses. So here they're telling you what amount, means it's not impairment. So here the question is, what amount of loss should Sun report in its year two earnings, in year two earnings? So, but we need to understand first year one also, and then we will move it to the year two. If you look at here, just let me put it here. So we have actually first year one, just I'm trying to explain the question. In year one, you have purchased investments for 650,000. We have a cost of investment, but it was classified as in year one trading. Okay, it was trading because we reclassified on year two. So trading security, we have a cost of how much? 650,000, it's given here. This is the cost. We have 650,000. And year one, we have a reporting date year one. This is the fair value at year one. How much fair value is? 575. So fair value is 575,000. And now you can see there is a loss, which is unrealized loss of, if you will take the difference, 650 minus 575. So you have a loss of 75,000. Whatever the answer, you can just check. You can just recalculate. So this is the unrealized loss. Of course, it was trading. So this loss should be reported to the income statement. Okay. And you, in your balance sheet, this value should be reported in the balance sheet as investment, current fair value. Okay. Now let's move to the year 2. In year 2, 30th June, first we have a June 30, okay, because at the June 30, we reclassified. This is the date of reclassification. And what we did, we are going to reclassify from trading to available for sale security. This is what happened, trading to available for sale securities. Now we need to check what was the market value at that day. So first, the point we need to remember, what was the value which you have reflected in the last balance sheet? That the value was 575,000. In last balance sheet, our asset is reported, I mean, so trading security is reported at 575,000. Now the fair value at the date of transfer is, this is the fair value, it's given here. 530,000. Now you can look at here, there is again a loss of 45,000. This loss is called unrealized loss, and this loss you have on June 30. Don't forget year two. Then you have a year two again. We have a year two. Okay. And now we have a, at the date of 31st December, I mean, say at the balance sheet date, what is going to happen? It means your investment will be recorded at fair value. This was the fair value at June 30. So we have a fair value, I mean to say investment value, because you have reclassified available for sale securities value. The last value is 530,000. And now the fair value at the reporting date is given here, 490,000. At 31st December year two, we have a 490,000. So if you will calculate here, so here you, again, you have a loss of 40,000. Again, this is unrealized loss. Okay. Now the question is that they are asking about what, because this is now here, this is classified as available for sale, because available for sale, this loss will go to OCI. Okay. But in the income statement, this loss will go to the income statement. Okay. At the date of reclassification. So if it's here, we have a question. What amount of loss should Sun report in its year two earnings? When he asked about earnings, it means you have to check what value will go to the income statement in year two. So in year two, we will take 45,000. But in year two, if he will ask you what amount will go to the OCI, so this should be the amount which should be recorded as unrealized loss in other comprehensive income. I hope, guys, it is clear. If you have any question, you can ask me through the comment section. See you in the next video. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.